children are...
Yeah, praise the Lord. Am I on? I got to find my normal joke here. Who remembers Paul Harvey? He was a commentator. Paul Harvey reports, a young couple invited their preacher for Sunday dinner. While they were in the kitchen preparing the meal, the minister asked their son what they were having. Goat, the little boy replied. Goat, replied the startled man of the cloth. Are you sure about that? Yep, said the youngster. I heard Paul say to Ma, might as well have that the old goat over today for dinner. Careful what you say around kids. Amen. Guys, I forgot to start that. Sorry. We're started now. I'm gonna go through this quick, these nine things. And the reason I'm just going to kind of read them to you because I got a bunch more that I want to say along this same line. What I want to talk to you about today, once again, blood covenant. Well, I realize I'll never get off of that. There's mockers of the blood in the body of Christ now. They mock the blood. They mock the blood covenant. It just seems so archaic and barbaric that blood, I mean, come on. But you know it's all about the blood. It's all about the, that's why Peter says in 1 Peter 1, it's the precious blood of Jesus. If you could just put this scripture up and leave it on the screen, I'm just going to read through this and then I'm going to get to the message. 3:25, I want you to see this. Romans 3:25, chapter 3, verse 25. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. Whom God, referring to Jesus, whom God hath sent forth to be a propitiation. We've talked about that word before. Has to do with the mercy seat on the Ark of the Covenant, right? Through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission or removal of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. But I want you to see this part, third line down, through faith in his blood. It's through faith in his blood. Through faith in his blood. I'm going to keep saying that. And then I'm going to share some things with you after I run through these nine covenant things, because I know that's how I'm going to get it done. I'm going to read some things about how there are preachers that are literally discounting the blood of Jesus. And we need a more, I know I need, I'll speak for myself, and probably you have to apply it to yourself. I need to be more conscious of what the blood of Jesus means. The blood of Jesus, see, look at this. It's through faith in his blood that we're declared righteous. Did you see that? It's faith in his blood. But, you know, that doesn't seem right to the 21st century mind. I mean, blood, I mean, isn't that kind of outdated? No, it's not. It's the precious shed blood of Jesus. The Bible says the life is in the blood. The life is in the blood, Leviticus 17:11. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me just run through these nine covenant things here, and then I'm going to get to my message. I talked about, number one, when two people made a covenant, which God made with his son. Number one, I talked how they took off their coat or their robe, which signified all that they were. Okay, I used the example of a police officer. If they take off your coat and you exchange coats, you have on that officer's coat, that represents who that officer is. The next thing people did is they took off their belt, their weapons belt, not that holds their pants up, okay? Their weapons, right? And they exchange weapons, which meant that anybody that comes against you, they're coming against me. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that so powerful? Do you know the Bible says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might? Ephesians 6:10. You know, one Greek expositor says it literally means God's muscles are backing you up. I mean, that's pretty awesome. That was the second thing. And when people made a covenant, then they cut the covenant. We talked about that last week. They split the animal and passed between the parts. Remember that? Okay, I'm going quick because I'm trying to get to the message. The fourth thing they did was that they raised their right arms and they mixed the blood. They mixed the blood. This was all part of blood covenant. Kenneth Copeland says it best when he says, the worst thing that ever happened to our society is we replaced blood with ink. Or the worst thing that ever happened to our society, I'm sorry, is we became modern. Because now we don't understand covenant. Amen? Because people, your word don't mean anything. Listen, you can tell a person by their word. You know the old saying, you're only as good as your word? You know, Jesus said, or the psalmist said in Psalm 138, verse 2, he's magnified his word above his name. I'm really trying to be sensitive to this more and more. If I tell you something, I mean, I've always been somewhat that way, but I'm really adamant about it because my word is my bond. See, this is why people have trouble believing the word of God, because their own word doesn't mean anything. You can't just get a little book and speak confessions and just, if your heart's not convinced, your heart's going, you don't put any value on words at any other time, why should this time be any different? By the stripes of Jesus, you're healed. You don't believe that. Your heart knows. That's why it must be assured. That's why if I live contrary to what I say I believe, I'm confusing my heart. And then when I go to try to receive, I can't receive because I got a confused heart. With the heart, man believes into righteousness. Into motion, and then with the mouth, confession is made into salvation, deliverance, healing, blessing, deliverance from the molestation of enemies. All that salvation means there. Soterian, sozo. Amen? So that's what they did. The next thing they did was exchange names. How many know we got the name of Jesus? But it's his name, but it's faith in his name. Right? Okay, so God gave us the name of Jesus. Isn't that interesting? There's power and authority behind that name if you understand what that name means. The next thing they did cut the covenant, raise your right hand, mix the exchange names. Oh, yes, make a scar. That was the next thing they did. That was number six. And the scar, and I'm going to read this quickly to you. I'm trying to find where this story... Okay, Henry Stanley, on his explorations through Africa, cut covenant 50 times with various chieftains or leaders of tribes. And we certainly understand why. Anytime he would come across an unfriendly tribe, he would just hold up that right arm with those 50 scars, and any would-be attacker would take off running in the other direction. Why? Because it meant that all of the authority of those people he's in covenant with was behind him. What is our mark? The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is our seal. That he's the one that enforces all of what Jesus has done. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:14, that good deposit is what the Greek says that we have. We keep or guard by the Holy Ghost which dwells in us. The Bible says the kingdom of God, Romans 14:17, is righteousness, peace, and joy, but it's in the Holy Ghost. Those are all things Jesus provided for. The Bible says in Romans 15:13, now the God of hope, fill you with all joy, confident expectation of good, fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through your own effort. No, through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's how you raise your right arm. Amen? When you enlist the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Ghost, koinonia in Greek, fellowship, intimacy of the Holy Spirit, he makes it all real. He makes what the love of the Father and what Jesus has done through his redemptive work, the Holy Spirit's the one that makes it all real. You know, I get concerned because I hear a lot of things about the mind, and that's good, but I get concerned when we leave the Holy Spirit out. Because you just can't think your way into this, guys. If I could think my way into this, I wouldn't need the Holy Ghost. He's the one, the Bible, Jesus said this, John 16:13. He's been sent to guide you into how much truth? All of it. All of it. All of it. And in the Greek, it's a picture of a tour guide taking people into an unknown country or an unknown area. We can't know the things of God, 1 Corinthians 2, except by the Spirit of God. I know. That's amazing. So that the next thing they did was they would give covenant terms. That's number seven. There's nine of them. They would give covenant terms. Now, how do we see our covenant terms? We go to the Word of God. Now, I want to show you something in case you ever run up to this thought in your mind. I had this thought years ago. How many know we need answers? Yeah. Questions are good. We just don't ask questions and like, yeah, right, God, if that's the case. No, we ask honest questions. We all have questions. In fact, the more answers you get, the more questions you have. It's called growth. Amen? But look at, I want to show you this Jeremiah 17:11. How do we need to understand our covenant terms? We need to, all right? Jeremiah 17:11. Most of you are familiar with this verse. Did I say 17:11? What did I say? 29:11, that's what I meant to say. If you were led of the Spirit, you would have known that. Just kidding. You know, y'all, you got to make things sound spiritual. I've learned this. I've learned this at home. When Jen would say, we take the garbage out, I say, well, that's not my ministry. God didn't call me to that. See, if you make it sound spiritual, you're covered. Like, most of you know this verse, right? Look at this. And I actually had a guy say this to me. This is why it's important to be familiar with our covenant terms. Now watch this. Most of you know this, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end, right? Now go to verse 1 of this same chapter, Jeremiah 29:1. Who's he talking to? Now these are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem unto the residue of the elders which were carried away captives, and to the priests and to the prophets and to all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away captive from Jerusalem to Babylon. I had a guy tell me this. He said this. He goes, that wasn't even written to us. It's quiet here, isn't it? Does that mean it doesn't apply to us? It does apply to us. It was, the book of Hebrews wasn't written to us. But it's written for us. Amen. It's all for us. Let me show you how to understand this. Does Jeremiah 29:11 apply to us? But here it says it was written to these people. Go to 2 Corinthians 1:20. I'm going to show you this. This is how you read the covenant terms. Every blessing in the Bible applies to you. Now watch this. For all, somebody say all.
All
the promises of God, including Jeremiah 29:11. All of them. Of God in Him are yea, or yes, and in Him, amen, unto the glory of God by or through us, the Greek says. Isn't that powerful? So Jeremiah 29:11 is included. Does that help you? Doesn't that help you? Because I used to read stuff and I said, wait a minute, that wasn't even to us. And the devil loves that. See, the Satan works in an environment of confusion. You understand that? See, if you're confused, you can be spun around by deception. He has no outright power. He's just a very good liar. He tries to indict God. You know, God is your answer. God is so for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The next thing they did, number 8, they would eat a memorial meal. We see this in the communion table, right? How important is it? How important is communion, to take communion? It's powerful if you do it in remembrance of Him and not about you. Can anybody hear that? See, that's why you take communion, because you're remembering what Jesus did, and that it's about Jesus and what He did at the cross and His death, burial, and resurrection. Amen? That by His stripes I'm healed.
Amen.
All those types of things. Okay? So that's important. You call to remembrance. And then the last thing they did, they would plant a memorial tree. The blood-sprinkled tree, along with our scar, will always be a testimony to our covenant. They would plant a tree. Let me show you this one Colossians 1:20. You know what I'm talking about. Come on. Hallelujah. Now, I'm actually getting to the message now. Colossians 1:20, I'm going to show you this. And having made peace, look at this terminology, through the blood of His cross. Through the blood of His cross. By Him, through Him, to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him I say, whether there be things in earth or things in heaven. Now stop. Notice it's the blood of His cross. But I want to show you something. This is some of the ways that some of these people that teach everybody's saved, whether they accept Jesus or not, they pull verses like this out of context and they don't read in context. Let's read on. And you who were aliens and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath He reconciled. Next verse. In the body of His flesh, through death, to present you, the ones who receive Him, holy and unblameable and unreprovable in His sight. Look at this next verse. If you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, made a minister. Now, I'm not saying that's saying that you can lose your salvation. You know, that's a big debate too. But I'm saying we need to keep our faith in Jesus. This is not saying everybody's automatically saved. You got to receive it, okay? Now to the message. All right. I've entitled this message, it's actually Covenant Defined Part 6, but if I can get it all in the title, Mockers of the Blood and the Sin Unto Death. Mockers of the blood and the sin unto death. Let me read some things to you just to show you some of the stuff that's going on. When Andrew preached on universalism at the conference, I knew we're on the right track, because I see some of this stuff that's coming up that people are doing who do not know the scriptures. And many of them outright deny the scriptures. You know, there's people that say that the words of Jesus are not valid because they were before the cross. Did you know that? Isn't that amazing? That the words of Jesus aren't valid because he hadn't yet went to the cross, so it was all old. He was dealing with all old covenant people. I agree with that. And I can show you out of Hebrews 9, we can talk about that. But let me show you what Paul said about the words of Jesus. Can I do that? 1 Timothy 6:3, watch this. Don't you love the word? God, I love it. Love, love it. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 3. If any man teach otherwise, and consent not to wholesome or healthy words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see that? And to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is right on. No. Read the next verse. He is proud. The Greek says he's wrapped up in the smoke of self-deception. Knowing nothing. You know what knowing nothing means? He's an expert at nothing. He's doting about questions. This has to do with a terminal disease and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, evil surmisings, hypnosis. He's under the control of his own mind. And of course, it goes on. You get the idea. So do the words of Jesus matter?
Yes,
amen. All right. So let me go with, I'm hoping to get to what is the sin unto death in 1 John 5:16. Here's one of the posts that I pulled off of the internet, off of Facebook. I'm deciding where to read. I know people who spend a lot of time with hurting people. Are they more powerful than some dainty white glove God? I doubt it. I tell you what God can't stand, and I think you can say this with some confidence because it is reflected in the life of Jesus. Watch this. Jesus couldn't stand the misrepresentation of God into a judgmental, exclusive, sacrifice-requiring jerk. And this man of peace was so incensed at the crap of the religious leaders that he called them vipers and tombs painted white on the outside full of dead men's bones. Now, if I told you who this was, some of you would know who this is. Notice a sacrifice-requiring jerk. They're mocking the blood. And it gets more blatant. There's people saying that God wasn't mad at man. Then what was the purpose of the cross? Sin had to be judged. If God wasn't mad at sin, he loved man. I will agree with that. And that the cross was just basically us killing Jesus. Sacrifice was required. See, if you deny the blood, there is no remission, Hebrews 9:22, without blood. None. None. And these, I'm telling you, these people are treating. Well, we just imitate the example of Jesus. The Bible says in Leviticus 17:11, the life is in the blood. Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Without faith in his precious blood, we don't experience life. It's all about the blood, people.
Amen.
And this next one I'm going to share with you. I mean, it's sickening. Sickening, and people are teaching this. And people that have been to this church, and I'm not the preachers, I'm not talking about that, but people that have visited here and come here. I know some people, and as soon as I see them, I'm going to ask them to come into my office, and I'm going to tell them what you're under is deception. You know why? Because I love them. I say, you don't have to come here. I don't care. That's not the point. But you do need to know that this is satanic, it's damnable, it's evil, and it'll cost you everything. That's the sin unto death. I'm getting ahead of myself, but we're going to get there. You know what the sin unto death means? You know what unto is in the Greek? Anybody know? Watch this. 1 John 5:16. Look at this. When you turn away from the blood, when you turn away from God's standard, you've turned away. Amen? That's why, you know, I'm finding out more and more about love. If I love people, I will tell them the truth as best I know it. But if I love me more than I love you and I don't want to offend anybody, then I love me. I hate you. Leviticus, I believe it's chapter 19, verse 17, says, thou shalt not hate thy neighbor. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. Something to that effect. Isn't that amazing? The Bible says, if I don't discipline, Gracie's not in here. She rarely gets a paddle. Notice I said paddle. Not time out. not stand in the corner and stew and get mad at me. See, that's not politically correct, but it's biblically correct. Amen. And she was really had an attitude towards Joel. She's not in here. I don't want her to hear this because I don't want to embarrass her. She's a good girl, but she's a kid, right? She's 9 years old. Rarely have to do it, but I had to light her up with the Board of Education on the seat of all knowledge. And I hated it. I really felt like God said, you got to deal with this. You got to cut it off. I don't want it to, Lord. You got to. I will. You know, when I hit the reset button a little bit later, you know, after she cried, I went and hugged her, told her I loved her. I said, Gracie, you're better than that. You don't act like that. She come in the room. She had her Bible with her. She said, Dad, you know, since they seen War Room, both Joel and Gracie, they have a prayer room. And she said, Dad, I'm going to go in and pray and stuff. She did all this. And this was after I hit the reset button. You know why? Because I love her. Foolishness, the Bible says in Proverbs, is bound or attached to the heart of a child, but the rod of correction will cut it off. But see, people don't want, come on. Dr. Spock says, Dr. Spock's a mess. I don't even know who he is. I've just heard the name. When I think of Spock, I think of Star Trek. All right. Watch this. If any man see his brother, sin a sin which is not unto death. Now look, if you got your Bible, every time you see that word unto in this verse, you ought to circle it. You ought to circle it. Because you know what the word unto means? It's the Greek preposition pros, P-R-O-S, pi, rho, omicron, sigma in Greek, and it means facing towards. One Greek expositor says face to face, nose to nose, eyeball to eyeball, rib cage to rib cage. It's used in Ephesians 6:12. But that's what it means. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not facing death, or Thayer also says it means with regard to. In other words, regard. So he sees him and his sin is not facing death. In other words, it's not going to cost him everything. He shall ask the one praying, and he shall give, God shall give the one praying life through his prayer for them that sin not facing death. Now watch the rest of this verse. There is a sin that faces death. I do not say that you pray for it. Now what is he talking about? What is this sin unto death that he says, I say, don't pray for this one. You know what's needed? Instruction. Serious instruction. There are people, and I know people, part of a group that teaches some of this gobbledygook stuff, and I actually heard a guy say it, they're dropping like flies. You know, these people that come and they say, well, since Jesus defeated death, we're never going to die. They asked Dwayne Sheriff about that one time, and he said, who taught you that? He says, where are they? They're all dead. But see, these things, people, guys, the blood, when you turn away from the blood, when you turn away from understanding it's about Jesus and not you, when you get into something, that's where, man, we serious instruction needs to come in. I'm going to say something, and you're just going to have to hear my heart. You need this church.
Amen.
I'm serious. You need to be in a new covenant church. I tell people all the time, you don't have to come here, but you need to. If you got another one, go to there, whatever. But you need to hear this all the time.
Amen.
There's things I'm really starting to believe that I've believed for a long time. Does that make any sense? It's getting in my heart. It's changing me. But it's a process. See, because we are inundated with unbelief all around us. That's why I'm playing that thing Thursday night. I'm praying that some of you come to hear it because it'll set you free. It'll help you. You'll be able to get some insight. Yes, God does want me healed. God does want me well. But it's a fight. Not with God. Just with the lies of the devil in this system, in this world. We're not backing down. We can't back down from the truth.
Amen.
We're so afraid of turning people off. They're already off. Turn them on. Amen. All right, now, moving around. So the sin that faces, let me show you another one. Go to Luke chapter 18. The sin unto death is when we do things our own way. It's iniquity. It's lawlessness. It's turning away from the blood sacrifice of Jesus. But look at Luke 18, verse 9, and down to about verse 14. I don't know if I'll read it all. I'm after something. Jesus, and he, Jesus, spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. You know a sign that you're trusted in yourself? You despise others. Can you see it? Well, if they were just like me, I mean, after all. You know what I'm learning in life? All of us need mercy.
Amen.
There we do. All of us. You may be better in an area than I am, but man, I covet your prayer. I want you to pray for me. Make mention of me in your prayers. I want to pray for you, man. We're attacking things in prayer. attacking. Because I'm finding out more and more, this is life and death. This is life and death. Why are you talking so much about the blood? Because the blood, the life is in the blood. Jesus shed his blood for us. The blood, Christ's blood, it says in Hebrews 12, speaks better things than that of Abel. What Abel's blood cried for vengeance, his blood cries mercy and grace. My word, this is good. You believe in pleading the blood? Absolutely. Absolutely. I know there's people, I've heard all that gobbledygob. And we talked last week, remember we talked about how Esau, he despised his birthright. Remember that? And the Bible says he sought it with tears. He sought it with tears, but he found no place of repentance. You know why? Because he sought it with tears instead of blood sacrifice. Amen? We don't seek it. It's because of the blood of Jesus. I walk up and say, my word, I got a covenant with God through the blood of Jesus. That's strong. The devil hates the blood. Why do you think when Jesus came and he knew it was prophesied and he had Herod kill all the baby boys under two, he's trying to stop the blood. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12 that the dragon stood at the feet of the woman to try to stop the covenant. Guys, this is awesome. This is awesome. You know what I find out the more I see this stuff? The more I understand this, the more I see it in my heart. And sometimes it's hard to get it out of my mouth. Because you see more with your heart than you do with your mouth. Guys, we're going to get into the five sacrifices in the Old Testament. You're going to see Jesus in them. You know two of them were mandatory and three of them were voluntary offerings? Do you know that's all significant? The mandatory one's the sin offering and the trespass offering. I don't want to get into all this. But you have to come through Jesus. But after that, you can decide how much of God you want or not. I suggest all of Him. Because the last offering, the peace offering, the only one the offerer got to partake of was the peace offering. That was after the whole burnt offering and the meal offering or the grain offering, which are connected and has to do with your dedication. Jesus dedicated Himself to God so you can dedicate yourself to God through the blood of Jesus. I'm getting ahead, sorry. But anyhow, and He spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and they despised others. Next verse. Two men went up into the temple to pray. The one was a Pharisee. Now the word Pharisee means separated ones. This was the religious elite. And the other a publican. Now watch this. The Pharisee stood and he prayed thus with himself. You know what that word with is in the Greek? Pros. He prayed toward himself. You can tell he did this. He was regard to himself. You know what the real definition of prayer is? If you look it up, pros yuchomai, and it has that preposition pros, and it means the rest of the word means to desire. In other words, set your desire towards God. There's good prayer, and then there's the kind that hypocrites love to pray. That's what this guy was. They were both praying. Would you agree? But one of them was praying toward himself. And the other one was looking towards God. He said, this is the Pharisee who prayed toward himself. And he said, and God, he addresses God. I personally believe that the devils couldn't even stand this prayer. That's my opinion. He said, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this publican. Isn't that something? He's despising the other guy that's praying there. Next verse. He's listing all of his credentials. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. Listen, are any of those things wrong? No. It's the motive behind what you do. Amen? It's the motive. God's more interested in why we do what we do. Are we looking at Him or are we looking at us? Are we despising others? Look at this. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. In other words, here's the point. As born-again children of God, you're not sinners. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But listen, this is talking about a motive and an attitude of the heart. This is before the cross. How does it apply to us? He humbled himself. He smote upon his breast, God, be merciful unto me. I'm convinced you can't really grasp grace until you understand mercy. When I understand how much mercy I've received and continue to receive, it enables me to find grace to help in the time of need. Hebrews 4:16. Isn't that something? See, I realize it ain't because I'm so great, it's because He's perfect. Amen. It's the blood. God sees the blood. It says the publican, he lifted, and saying, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Next verse, this guy, I tell you, this man, the one who humbled himself, went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalts himself shall be abased, and he that humbles himself shall be exalted. This is why the blood's so important. Without the blood, all I have is me. I'm not righteous because I'm so great. You weren't supposed to say amen there. But it's because he's so great. I'm kidding. Here, let me read some more here. I'm gonna share some more with you, and then I'll give you some more scripture verses. We're doing good on time, I think. It's called penal substitution. See, what people do is they create a God of their own design. Can I show you that? Romans 1. Let's go to Romans 1. I'll just start with verse 20, but I'm going to breeze through those verses till I get to where I'm headed. For the invisible things of him are clearly seen. Clearly seen. Clearly seen. Clearly seen. They're clearly seen, being understood by creation or the things that are made, even as eternal power and Godhead, so that people are without excuse. Do you know that science is finally catching up with the Bible? That's a whole subject. Next verse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Next verse. Professing themselves to be wise, they became morons. That's the Greek. Fools. Next verse. And changed the glory of the uncorruptible God, watch this, into an image made like to man. Keep this verse up there, please. And to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. They changed God's glory into an image like corruptible man. Let me give you an example. Here's a big one. Oh, there can't be a hell. How could a good God send people to hell? Who's ever heard that? Listen, the Bible says in Matthew 25 that hell was created for the devil and his angels. It was never God's idea, but if you choose to reject Christ, there is no other option. See, well, we just can't believe that. So we create a God of our own making. I was reading last night in Exodus chapter 4 about where Moses' wife, Zipporah, God stood in the way because of the circumcision to destroy them. So they circumcised their son and threw the foreskin at, that sounds wild to me, at down, and Zipporah said, you're a bloody man. See, we think, well, I can't, that ain't right. That ain't right. I remember a guy saying to me, how could God tell Abraham to offer his son Isaac? That was a big deal back in those cultures, you know that. In idolatry, they would offer their firstborn like that. And God was saying, listen, that we don't get the testing of Abraham, amen? We get the blessing of Abraham. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. But see, we desire because we don't. It doesn't make sense to our carnal thinking. We want to make it a God of our own image. God doesn't really require blood. He just requires me to be good enough. As long as I'm a nice guy or gal. No, it's blood. Without the blood, there is no remission. Hebrews 9:22. And that means release from bondage. You can't experience the life of God without the blood of Jesus. That's why Peter calls it precious blood. Precious blood. Let me read some more to you. This is we create a God of our own image many times. Let me show you another one. I've showed you this one, but I'm going to show it to you. Proverbs 14:9. Well, watch this. Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 9. Fools make a mock at sin, but among the righteous there is favor. I've told you before that Hebrew word there for sin literally means trespass offering. Look it up. It's the same Hebrew word that's used for trespass offering. Fools mock God's offering. They mock Jesus. They mock the blood. And they say, no, I'm good enough. God loves people so much. He does. He loves all. He so loved the world. But that's, he loves you so much, he gives you a free choice to accept or reject him. And not to accept him is to reject him. Any love that's forced upon somebody is called rape. Rape. Oh, I say, well, I'm not under that doctrine. But listen, a lot of times when we're passive, we don't realize the spirit that's influencing us. The spirit of grace motivates us. There's power in God. I want everything God's got. You notice I said the last of the five offerings is the peace offering. It was the only offering that the offerer could partake of. Some of you will get that. The peace of God's for all of us. We have it if we're born again. But how many know a lot of Christians don't walk in it? A lot of them. because they refused to offer their body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is their reasonable service. They continue to hold out, I want God on my terms. It's called creating a God in my own image. This is good news, guys. I love finding out I'm the issue. Because that means I can change. If God's the issue, there ain't nothing I can do. You know, people say stuff like, well, I wouldn't serve a God who put sickness on you. I would. I thank God he doesn't. I thank God he doesn't. But he's God. Amen? Thank God he does it, that he's a healer, that he's the answer, not the problem. But this ain't about me making God what I think he... This is about me conforming to his image, not him conforming to mine. That's what people do. Let me get some of this. Oh, we're doing good. Oh, I'm excited. Creating a God. There's a series that this Bible teacher's teaching called No Penal Substitution. That means there's no substitution because you're already right. God really wasn't mad. When the Bible says the wrath of God abides on those who don't believe, in John 3:36, it's the Greek word orge, and it means anger. People are saying, no, God really wasn't angry. That's sin. Yes, he was. Sin has to be judged. The good news, it was judged in Jesus. So now you and I can freely receive that. Oh, I'm excited. I'll just read some of this. I won't read too much, so give me a bucket in case I have to throw up. Watch this. No penal. We've been dealing with the fact that God never desired, wanted, or was pleased with animal sacrifices in the Old Testament. They were necessary for man to approach God. Necessary. Without the blood, there's no remission, which means release from bondage. None. Without blood. Without blood. That's why Cain's offering was rejected in Genesis 4. Talked about it last week, right? Abel brought a blood sacrifice. Cain brought the fruit of his own labor, of his own works. Probably a really good offering, but it was just vegetables, no blood. Amen? I know sometimes I think, come on, Chris. 21st century, that's exactly what the devil wants you to believe. Remember our scripture we talk about out of Romans 3:25? Faith in the blood. My word, I'm righteous. My word, you're righteous. You're born again. Keep your faith in the blood. Keep your faith in what Jesus did. His blood was sinless. It was perfect. And all that's been given to you as a free gift. You just have to say yes to it. All right, now watch this. I'll read a little bit more and then I'll get in. It goes into how the prophets of the Old Testament, along with David, they questioned this theology, even while deeply entrenched in it at the time. The time has come for the body of Christ where we must realize our evangelical, or we must question our evangelical theology as well. And it goes on to say, the Old Testament prophets mentioned were questioning the sacrificial system of their day. They're doing it today too. This person's doing it. The sacrificial system of our day is Jesus. For by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are sanctified. Hebrews 10:14. That's our sacrificial system of the day. See, that's what these people are saying that are teaching these things. They're saying God really wasn't mad. I'm going to show you scriptures. Sin had to be judged, people. Good news, it was judged. God is so full of love that even in the Old Testament, even in the Old Testament with the children of Israel, he set up a sacrificial system. That's why it says in Numbers 23, I have not beheld iniquity in Jacob. I haven't seen any iniquity. Why? Because they were under the sacrificial system, which was a type of the blood of Christ, and God didn't see unrighteousness. As soon as they got into idolatry and left that, guess what? There had to be judgment. That's why the Bible says in Revelation 18:4, come out from among them. Come out from Babylon. Come out from confusion. My people, my people, my people, that you receive not of her sins. You've already been judged for yours, and that you receive not of her plagues. Come out. Amen. Of this religious confusion. Amen. It's exactly what he's talking about. Exactly what he's talking about. The Bible says in Proverbs 21, verse 16, that he that wanders out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. You guys are blessed, blessed, blessed. But the blessing is up to you to receive. Amen. It's not just going to happen to you because God loves you. It's there for you. But you're going to have to take hold. That's why he says, lay hold upon eternal life. That means seize upon it. Grab it. Pull it in and say it's mine. Amen. Amen. It's called faith. Faith doesn't make something happen. Faith merely receives what's already happened by grace. Hallelujah! Oh, I get so excited. Thank you, Jesus. Now back to calm. All right, the surrounding nations, watch this. The surrounding nations of Israel were heavily entrenched in mythology which crept into Israel's worship. They're calling the sacrificial system mythology. Sick beyond sick. This is turning people away from blood. No wonder they're dropping like flies. No wonder they're dying prematurely. If we would judge ourselves and make sure our faith is in Jesus Christ and His precious blood, we would not fall into the same condemning sentence that the world's already under that doesn't acknowledge the blood sacrifice of Jesus Christ. That's what He's saying. Keep your faith in the blood. Keep your faith in what I did. Amen. Hallelujah. Now let me move. I'm not going to try to read all this. They haven't called to Mithun. They carried over into the animal sacrifices. Today, we have doctrines as well which have been influenced by penal substitution and have crept into evangelical Christianities. Doctrines like God killed His Son in order to be appeased of His anger towards mankind. Jesus willingly laid down His life, it says in John 10, because of His love for us. Oh, I guess this stuff makes me angry. It's called righteous anger. You know God created you to be angry? Some go. Yeah. The Bible says, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 and 27, He says, be angry and sin not. In other words, gear your anger towards where it needs to be geared towards. You that love the Lord, hate evil, Psalm 97:10. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, arrogancy, and the evil way, and the perverse mouth I hate, Proverbs 8:13. Now think with me on this. God said, be angry and sin not. We just think that's a marriage verse. If you get mad, make sure you don't go to bed angry. Well, that's a good thing, but that's not what it's talking about. In the Greek, it's in the present tense. Be angry, stir yourself up, and stay angry. Why? The next verse says, if you don't, you give place to the devil. When we stop being mad at evil, when we stop being mad at doctrines like this, when we stop our anger, we're giving place to the devil. Well, I don't want to be misinterpreted. Can I tell you something? You will be. You will be. Who cares what they think? All I care about is what God thinks.
Amen.
He loves me. And He's my defense attorney. He's the prosecutor of the devil. Just like this Supreme Court thing, I'm telling you, they're jamming it down our throat and it's wrong. And thank God, the body of Christ is finally waking up. You've awakened the sleeping giant. You've overplayed your hand. Hallelujah. We can just create Christians to vote and vote the right way. Not Republican, Democrat. It's not about that. It's about righteousness.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Doctrine, God killed His Son, doctrines like Jesus had to bear the judgment of God in order for man to become righteous. They're saying this is a false doctrine. Jesus had to bear the judgment of God. Sin had to be judged. Good news, it was in Jesus. Our part, just put faith in Him. Just say yes to the blood sacrifice. And I could go on and on and on. But let me give you some more blood verses. Are you ready? Well, let me start with, was God angry? Isaiah 54, verse 7. Watch this. Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 7. I could go on and on and on because they keep calling it mysticism. Mythology. It's terrible. For a small moment, this is prophesying of what Jesus did. For a small moment have I forsaken thee. Let me stop. Now there's a bunch of people, and I could name names here too, are saying that God the Father did not forsake Jesus at the cross. When it's all over the place. In the cross, it's prophesied in Matthew 22. All these different areas where it talks about God forsook Jesus. What did Jesus say? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? My God, the Father, my God, the Holy Spirit. He was the Son. Why have you forsaken me? Why? So He would never forsake you. That's why it says He'll never leave you nor forsake you. See, everything's done judicially. Because we don't understand it. Oh God, I'm sincere. Please move. He can't. He only moves within the realm of covenant. That's all He can do. That's why truth is so important. To grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For a small moment have I forsaken thee, referring to Jesus, but with great mercies will I gather thee. Next verse. Hallelujah. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. Next verse. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me, for as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over thee, or so have I sworn that I would not be wroth with thee nor rebuke thee. Next verse. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on these. You know, because of Jesus being forsaken, he calls it a small moment, we'll never be forsaken. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The next verse says, so that we may boldly say, boldly say, boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Most Christians are cowering. I mean, listen, I deal with fears like everybody else. We all have them. That's why there's strength in numbers. All right, moving right along. I'm going to finish up here. I really am. Let me see here. One more. Let's do 1 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, I'm sorry. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. Yeah, we'll do 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 6. And I'm gonna start. Yeah, I'll read through verse 10. Who hath also made us able ministers? God made us. Say, God made me. An able minister of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Next verse. Remember, the life is where? In the blood. Okay, new covenant. There was animal blood under the old covenant. Under the new covenant, there's Peter calls the precious blood of Jesus. Now, moving right along. But if the ministration of death, talking about the old covenant, it was an administration of death. Why? Because it was constant condemnation. They had to constantly offer sacrifices. Guess what? We only have one sacrifice that we put faith in. For by one offering, once again, Hebrews 10:14, the one offering of Jesus, he is perfected. Say, I'm perfect. Forever. Them that are sanctified by the blood, by him. Amen? He has perfected me. All right? For the administration of death, written and engraven in stones, referring to the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments weren't bad, but man's inability to keep them, that was the problem. Watch this. It was glorious so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. Next verse. In other words, the old covenant had glory. That's what I want you to see. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious, or greater glory, or much more? Next verse. For if the ministration of condemnation, see, the old covenant constantly condemned you, told you you're a sinner, you're sorry, you need another sacrifice. We don't need any more sacrifices. We've had the ultimate sacrifice. We can rejoice in that. Amen. That's why when you get condemnation coming and you start declaring, I'm righteous by the blood of Jesus. I'm blessed because of what Jesus did. He shed his precious blood for me. That's much greater than any negative thing you can do, say, or think. For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more, everybody say much more, doth the ministration or the administration of righteousness exceeding glory. One more verse. No. For even that which was made glorious. Now, here's what I want you to see. The old covenant had glory, right? Say, the old covenant had glory. Now let me finish this verse and I'll show you something. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory of this new covenant which excelleth. Now jump down to verse 18. Watch this. Watch this, watch this. The last verse in this chapter. But we all, with open or an unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror or a glass, the glory of the Lord... The glory of the Lord, remember we were talking about the old covenant had glory and the new covenant has greater glory. Our change metamorphosis into the same image. Notice, not God conforming to my image, to his image. Here, see it? We are changed or metamorphosed into the same image. Not one of the same kind, but the same image. Isn't that good? From glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. How many glories you see there at the end? Glory to glory. I used to think it was glory to glory, to glory to glory, glory. What glory am I in now? I don't know. I'm in one of them. It's not what it's talking about. We are metamorphosed from the glory of the old covenant performance into the new covenant where I'm declared righteous by the blood of Jesus. Two glories. Glory of the old covenant, glory of self-performance, and the glory of the new covenant, the blood of Jesus. Can you see that? Powerful stuff. Powerful stuff. We are so blessed. So blessed. I know it's later than it's ever been. One quick verse. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, starting about verse 17. I'm just going to say these verses quick. I want to do this whole thing, but... And if you call on the Father, who without respect of persons, He judges according to every man's work, singular. Remember in John 6, verse 28, the disciples asked Jesus, what must we do to work the works of God? Jesus said in verse 29 of John 6, this is the work, singular, of God that you believe on, or literally believe into Him whom He has sent. That's the work of God. That'll change your works. That is the work, one work. That's why He says, well, God isn't a respecter of persons. Every man will be judged according to every man's work, singular, past the time of your sojourning here in fear. Next verse. For as much as you know that you were redeemed, with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain lifestyle, that's Old English, or your way of living, received by traditions from your fathers, that's what, not what you redeemed with. Next verse. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. And for people to come along and say that the blood doesn't matter and compare it to mythology is disgusting beyond belief. Maybe it doesn't fit into our 21st century understanding, but God required a blood sacrifice and Jesus provided it, and I'm keeping my faith in what Jesus did. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Be very careful. I'm telling you, this stuff is worse than you think. I know we're somewhat bubbleized here, but I'm telling you, it's out there. The devil hates what Jesus did, and he will discredit it in any way he can. See, most of us came from intense legalism, where we were doing everything to try to be right with God. And now we're, oh, you don't do nothing because it doesn't matter. God's just so cool. He just said, man, I like you, Rich. I'm just going to give it to you whether you want it or not. I'm just going to, oh, that blood stuff, that's old-fashioned. Come on. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. The life is in the blood. You want to experience abundant life? It's in the blood. I want to tell you this. Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10, most of you know it, the thief, he didn't come but to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I've came that they might have life, Zoe, God kind of life, the same quality of life that God has, and that more abundantly. And you know, we always say the thief is the devil, and yes, that definitely is true. No doubt about it. But that thief works through thieves. Because the Bible says in that same chapter, John chapter 10 and verse 1, if any man attempts to climb up any other way outside of Jesus Christ and the blood sacrifice, he is a thief and he is a robber. I have just got to stop. I don't know how to stop, but I just have to. Say one more time. Faith in the blood. In the blood of Jesus. That's why we take communion. Amen? That's why we take communion. We buy His stripes. The bread, I am healed. And because of the blood, sin is not an issue with me because of the blood. Amen? Thanks. Everybody say thank you for